Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome you all to our webinar series 2.0 2020 organized by GIS Institute of Advanced Studies and Research, in short GIS IASR, Kolkata. Myself, Dr. Shubhankar Singh, Assistant Professor of GIS IASR. I am the host for today's webinar. And first of all, thank you very much to all of you for joining this particular webinar. And before I am going to introduce today's speaker, I am taking some time to say a few words about our institute very briefly, especially for the first time participants of our webinar series. Basically, GIS Institute of Advanced Studies and Research, in short GIS ISR Kolkata, is a newborn institute of only a year old. We aim to drive translational research oriented education at the postgraduate level and PhD research level also in the areas of data science. As you can see, Center for Data Science and Center for Health Science and Technology, as well as in the Center for Interdisciplinary Science. We are offering different MTech program, MTech and MSc programs in the umbrella of our institute. Basically, we are offering courses at this particular stages like MTech in computer science and engineering with specialization in machine learning and also specialization in data science. Apart from that, we are also offering courses like MTech in bioinformatics, MTech in sensor technology and IoT. And also we offer MSc programs in medical biotechnology and bioinformatics, and also as well as MSc in polymer science with specialization of paints and coatings. As I mentioned, this is a newborn institute, so we are doing a lot of activities in research and particular academic domains. So I request our attendees to go for our Facebook page to get connected with our present things, what we are doing, and also please visit our website at www.gisiasr.org to know more about our institute. So anyway, as part of our regular academic and research activities from the Center of Interdisciplinary Sciences of GIS ISR, we are going to start a two-day series of webinar. One is today and another will be held on coming Monday, that is on August 10, and where we will talk about different aspects of sustainable materials, mainly polymeric materials and organic biomaterials, and their various applications, including chemical and biosensors. The webinar will also discuss about the research and career prospects in those fields, and primarily for master's students as well as PhD researchers. So on this very first day, I would like to introduce today's speaker now, Dr. Hello.
Yeah. Hello. Yeah. I think your connection.
Hello.
Yeah. Your connection was cut. Now you are live again. Please continue.
Hello. Can you listen to me?
Yeah. Dr. We can Saha? Hear you. Yeah. Hear you.
Hello.
Yes, we can hear you.
Oh, yes. So on this very first day, I would like to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Prasneet Saha. And Dr. Saha has been associated with GIS ISR Kolkata as an assistant professor at the Center for Interdisciplinary Sciences. He is also a DST inspired faculty. He has completed his PhD from IIT Kharagpur. After completing his postdoctoral research from South Korea, he was attached with IIEST Sipur as an inspired faculty from 2015 to 2019. His primary research focus is based on development of polymeric biomaterials and medical implants using 3D printing and electrospinning techniques. He has extensive experience in polymer synthesis, natural polymers for fire retardant, antimicrobial coating applications. As a part of this webinar series today, he is going to present a talk on the polymer science and technology and 3D printing. Hope you will enjoy the talk. If you have any queries and comments, please feel free to write in the question and answer section. Professor Saha will address those after finishing his talk. Okay, with much delay, I am going to hand over the stage to Professor Saha to start his talk. Professor Saha, can you listen? Yeah, can you listen? Okay, now you.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Shingo. Thank you for such a nice introduction. And I would like to welcome all the attendees. I can see the attendees are numbers are pouring in. And good afternoon, good morning, and good night wherever the attendees are. As because I guess attendees are from all over the world. So today, let me share my screen first. Dr. Shingo, is my screen visible?
Yeah, visible. Can you make it full screen?
Yeah. Yes. Okay. So,
okay, fine.
As Dr. Shingo has already informed all the attendees that today this is our 2 days long webinar series based on the sustainable materials. So, under this broad area, we will cover two subtopics. You can say the sub research area. One would be based on polymer science and technology, as well as 3D printing. And in next Monday, Dr. Shingo himself will be presenting his work on the sensor and advanced materials and their applications. So yeah, this is Prosenjit Saha. I am working as an assistant professor at JIS Institute of Advanced Studies and Research. And basically, I represent the Center for Interdisciplinary Sciences of JIS IASR. So let us start, begin our discussion, some lectures for this webinar. So first, I would like to share a few of our details that actually where we are located. Our institute is located at Salt Lake, Kolkata. It is in West Bengal. And to be very specific, it is in Salt Lake Sector 5. And you can see our the photograph of our institute. You can come to our institute at the 17th floor of this building, and you can see some most beautiful scenery throughout the institute, from the institute. And we already have organized several scientific events like MOUs and National Science Days and other events. The pictures are there. And who we are actually, you may be having this question in your mind that what JIS IASR is exactly doing. Basically, we established our institute in 2019 under the JIS Educational Group in West Bengal as a constituent of JIS University. And our motto is to drive the translational research-oriented education at postgraduate and research level on some cutting-edge scientific and technological streams. And we have the tradition of 22 years of education and research under JIS Group. And we have about 30 institutions who are dedicated for the research and education at, from starting from undergraduate to the topmost level. We have thousands of students. We are training those students for several years. And our institute especially is being formed under the esteemed leadership of Professor Ajay Kumar Ray, eminent educationalist and researcher, and presently he is the director of our institute, that is JIS IASR. So let's move into the next slide. As we all know, there is a tremendous setback for SDG. So you might be asking, what is SDG? It is actually the Sustainable Development Goals. In short, it is called SDG. These goals were taken, or I may say say that it was adopted by all United Nations member states in 2015 to make sustainable this world as a universal call to action to end the poverty, protect the planet, and ensure that all people enjoy peace and prosperity by 2030. That is the aim. But as we all know, due to this COVID-19 situation, this COVID-19 poses a major setback for all of us who attain this SDG, that is Sustainable Development Goal, especially for the developing countries like us. So there are 17 goals were taken, and due to this pandemic situation, we are facing some major setback for this attainment of this goal. So why this setback? I should say that is setback, but why this setback is visible? Because of these following points. Because of this crisis, I should say crisis, because we are not facing a single crisis. After this pandemic, we are going to face several crises, like the global job crisis. It is highest in last 80 years. About 400 million people lost their job globally. And in India, it is more than 100 million. The healthcare system is about to reform. Everything we are going to, we should change most of the healthcare system. And also the recession, economic slowdown throughout the global market, and billions of kids out of school. Not only that, in addition to this crisis, we already have the pre-existing crisis like climate crisis, natural calamities. So in this scenario, what is needed actually? We need some leadership skill. We need some leader who will show the path for attaining the crisis resiliency. To resist this crisis, we should understand the societal need, and we should ready to take the challenges. So these are the these are the qualities that our leader or our future generation should have. So in this regard, the sustainable crisis resistant or crisis resilient approaches should be based on some science, technology, innovation model, because as you know, the science is something that can investigate the problem, that can identify the problem, but technology is something that can give the solution to the problem, and finally innovation is the transformation of the solution to the every corner of the society. So this is the model, this is the sustainable model, that identification or analysis followed by solution and transformation. So this model should be adopted. In addition to that, we should aim to enhance our manufacturing capacity as a nation. We should give thrust to the circular economy so that the scientific research and technological development should bring back the money that is called circular economy, and it will be again to be invested in further scientific developments. That means the translational research is the call for the time. And in addition to that, obviously the climate concern, because the climate has to be sustainable. Without this sustainable climate or environment, we cannot survive. And finally, what COVID has teached us, that we should be digitally ready. We should adopt the digitization. These are the points. Or during this pandemic, there are some inventions in some local level and by some common people. As we, for an example, we all should know that the virologist, the famous virologist Dr. Bhosle, she did her research in the development of the diagnostic kit for the COVID-19. She is based on the MyLab Discovery in Pune company, and she submitted her design kit just a day before she delivered her daughter. So this is kind of example
by some young scientists like us that should be followed for the present and the future generation. Not only the scientists, but some common people, they also have developed some innovation in small scale. Like you can see in the picture, somebody in South India, mostly it is in Karnataka, they developed some sanitization system where you need not to touch the whole system. In the middle of this picture, you can see a simple aluminium fan where you, we along with a nozzle, high-speed nozzle to sanitize the big area during pandemic. And also in East Sikkim, you can see the sanitization system for disinfecting the vehicles, commercial vehicles. This kind of innovation have been developed during this pandemic and by some very common people from the society. So these are the positive things that should motivate us.
Dr. Saha,
yes.
Hello.
Yeah.
Just a minute for a short, small interruption. Actually, I think due to bad weather for all the attendees, I would like to mention one thing, that due to bad weather, the internet or broadcast system is somehow low. So that's why somehow sometimes voice is going down. So we are very sorry to all the attendees. Please, we hope the internet connection will be fixed very soon. And thank you, Dr. Saha. Please, you can continue.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Singho. If there is any problem, technical problem like internet connection, you can write in the chat so that we can, if it is in our hand, we can rectify. Otherwise, nothing to do with this kind of situation. Anyway, in this circumstances, like I was discussing, that what is the significant role of our institute, especially our center? So we are mainly concentrating on four key sustainable development goals to be attained in next few years, let's say in next 10 years. And it should be like, one is the good health for well-being, clean water and sanitation, industry innovation and infrastructure, and responsible consumption and production. These are the four key goals that we are aiming for. And to attaining these goals, we are primarily offering some courses like MSc in Polymer Science and Technology, MTech in Sensor Science and IoT. Also, we are offering PhD program in relevant areas and some diploma and certificate program, keeping in mind these four sustainable goals. So actually, what we do in CIS, we just act as a bridge, you can say, between industry and academia. Our role is to connect our students to several industries or several need-based industries, so that the industry and academics can jointly grow and to attain this objective, we mainly work on some several aspects of material and polymers. Like we are working on polymer and 3D printing. Dr. Singho, my colleague, is working on sensor technology and IoT. And overall, our another strong pillar of our research is to sustainable product design. So you can see under each of these categories, we are basically emphasized on developing some product-oriented research. Like we are hoping to develop this kind of biomaterial, like artificial skin, paints, durable paints, coating, some newly designed drugs. We are working on designing of sensors, like environmental sensors, biosensors, food grade sensors. We are also working on developing or fabricating some bioplastics for the sustainable environment. We are also working on water purification system using some very low cost and natural elements. So these are the work going on in our institute, and these are the existing research facilities at our center. You can see we have biopolymer lab, sensor lab, we have spectroscopic lab, we have rotor evaporator, LOI, electric spinning setup, bioprinter. So these are the things we have. So the young generation who is thinking of doing the courses on some exciting areas, the polymer could be for them. And I personally are looking after this course on polymer, MSc in polymer science, and we are offering this program. And you all are welcome to visit our website, our center, and to see what is going on. Mainly this program on polymer in MSc in polymer science and technology gives you a unique opportunity to take specialization based on your own personal interest. So new education policy is also saying that we should have the flexibility to take the specialization. Keeping in mind, we are working on this, and the program will provide a solid base in the combination of chemistry, physics of organic materials with some biological sciences. So this connection is important, and why it is important, I will come to it in later stage. So these are the program highlights that of our MSc course. We are giving thrust on the research industrial training. We have excellent need-based curriculum activities. Our syllabus is made by some pro from industries and famous academic, national academic institutes. The professors, they are contributing to make our syllabus. We have some option for scholarships for extraordinary meritorious students. We have a strong in-house research facility at CIS. We have excellent placement support for our students, and we are always encouraging our students to be a job creator, not the job seeker. To this, to fulfill this objective, we always prefer that our students shall start a startup company after the end of this, even during this MSc courses, and it will give them the self-sufficient or self-confidence what is needed. And these are the brief outlines of the MSc program we are offering, that student will be trained to design, synthesis, characterization, production, and development of polymeric materials. This course will cover huge areas under polymers like plastic, rubber, fiber, paper and wood, biomaterials, and other biological polymers. This course will be on the processing and manufacturing techniques for different polymeric materials. That is the urgent need for the industry, polymer industry. And we emphasize on eco-friendly solution in polymer world. This is obviously a two-year course. First year will cover the in-depth fundamental aspect of polymer science and technology. And the second year will be based on the research-driven curriculum, and the final semester of the second year will be project work. So student will have the freedom to choose the following specialization. These three specializations we are going to offer. One is paints and coatings, one is biomaterials and advanced materials. These are all our cutting edge specializations to meet the industrial need. And this, the project work that I was talking, this project work will be carried out in the last term in some reputed industries, related industries, and also in some leading academic institutes like IITs and others. So this work will be based on the making a thesis or report that can be jointly supervised by one faculty from JIS, IISR, and one faculty or one industrial person from the external industry or institute. So finally, we are hoping that the result will be presented in a form of thesis, or if possible, we can publish the student's work in some reputed journal during the MSc. I'm talking about during the MSc. So why should you opt for this MSc program? As you know that Louis Pasteur once said, the fortune always favors the prepared mind. So here in JIS, IISR, CIS, that is Center for Interdisciplinary Science, we are helping our students for learning, training, and preparing themselves. So you must opt for this program, because if you if you want to be a winner, you must opt for this program. Why you should be a winner? Like, because we have wide career of opportunity in this course. You should have the access to internationally acclaimed faculty members in our center. We have the networking with academics and industry. We have need-based curriculum and skill development mechanism. And we have exceptionally strong and advanced research facilities. And we have reputed and trusted leadership with us. So this WINNER, this winner. So in your life also, everybody of us is like to be a winner. So this course is igniting the young mind for to become a winner. So one by one, I should discuss why wide opportunity means. Like in polymer especially, there are several career scopes in industry, academics, and always in government agencies. And because of the polymer science is a product oriented, and the industry is expecting to hire so many polymer scientists or chemists in next 5 years. And this plan is also in coherence with the national driven policies like Atmanirbhar Bharat, initiated by our honorable Prime Minister, Make in India. These policies are always in coherence with our plan or with our expertise in polymer science and technology. And as I already said, our aim is to make our student a job provider, not a job seeker. So this is the opportunities, and I'm trying to show you some career prospects after this course. Like in academics, in our research, in industries, you shall have this kind of opportunities. Even at the same time, parallelly, you can start up your own business also based on some products from polymer. So these are the industries I was talking about, like agriculture industry. You can be absorbed as a scientist or technical expert, like paint and coating, like 3D printing, implant design. You can be absorbed as QC manager, trainee. Like rubber and tire industry, you will be absorbed as R&D scientist, quality control manager, and the technical sales engineer or startup. Plastic and packaging industry, like biosafety products, PPE is very much now is the need for the time, for the present time. Biomedical instrumentation, automobile, pharma, adhesive, alternative energy, biotechnology, oil and gas, synthetic fibers and textile industry, and so many, like even nanotechnology. So who are the key players that may require the polymer scientists in national level? And those players are like Indian Oil Corporation Limited, Reliance Industry, Haldia Petrochemical, Gale, GE Plastics, SABIC, BASF, LG Polymers, Tata Chemicals, DuPont, Dow, Bayer, and several industries. They are frequently recruiting the people with polymer science or polymer chemistry background. So keeping in view this opportunity, we are making our students industry ready, so that they can fulfill the criteria for those industries. So there is a bright future for polymer. Why I am saying this? Because of this statistic. Here you can see the mostly in 2020 to 2030, the consumption of materials will be very high for the polymers, especially for the composite polymers, for the plastics, compared to the metal. Here you can see the conventional steel consumption is getting lower. At the same time, the composite consumption of composite in 2030 will be very, very high. And with this composite, out of this composite, polymer composite will I'm sure that will get 80% of this consumption of total composite. And in addition to that, you can also see other consumption of other plastics also. So this is the scenario is coming in next 10 years. So we should be prepared. and some high-end application of polymer. As you can see that in automobile, everything interior, starting from interior paints, even coating on the glass, all are from polymer, including the tires. Like in tractor, you can see most of the tractor, the hood in the external part, this hood, the shed is made of polymer, glass polymer composite. So at the similarly, this footover bridge nowadays are made with some polymer composite, which is easy to install and very low maintenance cost. Some other example would be the packaging, like polymers are substituting some non-recycling single-use plastic. Some bioplastics is in the market, and it is going to take the most of the consumption of the plastic material, this green polymer, and this plastic, single-use plastic will be replaced by the multiple-use plastic. I mean, the bioplastic will take the part of this plastic which are not recyclable and non-biodegradable. So as I said, that we also have our strong point, or our strength is our internationally reputed faculty members. As you can see, all the faculty members from the academic institute which are internationally of high repute or from IITs, and we are working together in a coherent manner to we jointly took the objective to fulfill this objective. We are working jointly, and we also encourage some potential candidate to join us as a faculty member in future, so that this institute can grow. And the networking part, we all already have some MOUs with some institutes like IIT Kharagpur, Mahatma Gandhi University from Kottayam. Also, we are trying, we are working together with several CSIR labs and NIPAR Kolkata, SN Bose Center for Basic Science, IPA Dresden, Pohang Institute of Science and Technology from South Korea. We are also having more with Indian Paint Association, and we are working in the close relation with Confederation of Indian Industry. Here you can see the picture in the left. We have the MOU signed with IIT Kharagpur last year, and also we have the MOU with Mahatma Gandhi University. You can see Professor, the VC of Mahatma Gandhi University signing MOU in the figure on the right hand side. So what would be the outcome in terms of skill, or you may say that what the skills are needed, or what the skills you will obtain after or during this course is the our analytical skill, fundamental skill, or communication skill. So in terms of analytical skill, our students after this course will have some mathematical and statistical technique. They will have the analytical instrumentation technique. They will learn this technique to characterize the properties and performance of several polymeric materials. They would have the critical thinking, problem solving attitude, and analytical skill to determine which test to interpret the result of the test conducted. They would have some fundamental understanding of the structure, composition, and property of polymers and other materials. They may have some self-sustained model, innovative mind to initiate the startup for the circular economy. And in terms of communication skill, they must have obtained the skill after this course for excellent writing skill, oral skill, to present their work, to send their work in terms of in the form of journal articles to several journals. So these are the skills to be highlighted during this course. Now come to the research of our center. Today I will just briefly cover the research that my group is doing, basically on polymer science and technology. And in the next day, Monday, we will be having the discussion from my colleague Dr. Shingo on sensors. So basically my group is called the polymer research group in JIASR Kolkata, and we are in true sense, we are valuing the interdisciplinary approach. As you can see, we are working on starting from biomaterials to protein to composite and even water purification. So let us have a quick look of the group research. Recently, we during this pandemic, we have started research on development of some nano coating or polymer-based antiviral coating using some very common herbal ingredients like turmeric. Curcumins are the active ingredient which can be photoactive. And we also are trying to use some extract from green teas or to make it antiviral. We are also trying some natural surfactant to coat the any kind of household fabric. And you can see this fabric is coated with curcumin and green tea extract along with the surfactant. Finally, the mechanism would be like this. If you spray the coating ointment directly on any cotton cloth, this will be will become the kind of antimicrobial or antiviral due to the active ingredient, and they can have the potential to kill the virus or kill the outer spike of the virus. So the details I cannot disclose because it is under research. So yeah, if you can contact personally, I can discuss it in more detail. We, during this lockdown pandemic, we already in the initial stage, we developed some household shielding materials. This is 100% use of the waste household materials. And nowadays it is available in plenty, but the initial lockdown period, it was in the demand was there. And our students and our faculty members at that time during March, they already developed this kind of technique. And finally, tissue engineering is our strong point in our research group. And as you know, that tissue engineering is based on four major components. And it is actually the repairing of any kind of organs or tissue by replacing a fresh kind of tissue. But the tissue itself cannot grow. You need to have some environment to grow the cells into the tissue. And finally, you have to keep this composite material or the scaffold into the bioreactor. And you can then, you can after maturation, you can replace the affected organ or affected area by this new scaffold or tissue. So the thing is that we are basically out of these four major area, we are basically concentrating on scaffold, which is based on polymer. And let us see what kind of polymers we are using mainly. There are three options. One is proteins, polysaccharides, and polynucleotides for this natural polymers for biomaterial tissue engineering application. And our group is mainly interested in working with the polysaccharide. Out of this polysaccharide, we have alginate, chitin, glycosaminoglycan, cellulose. So these are the polymers we frequently use, and you can see the abundance of these polymers are very simple or very frequent. You can extract it from plant, from algae, from insect. And the function of this polymers is basically to provide the mechanical retention, water retention, mechanical strength, and the shape and the form of the scaffold. So let us see the advantage of this natural polymers are the physiologically, they will provide the mechanical properties. They are very well bioactive. That is the main criteria for the biomaterial. They have degraded, they can degrade easily by the enzymes, and most importantly, they are kind of less inflammatory response. But there are some disadvantages, and we are mainly working on these disadvantages. The disadvantages are they are more complicated to manipulate the synthetic polymer, and physical modification are required. So these two aspects, that modification of the physical modification, like this one, and the more complicated manipulation to for the comparable with the synthetic polymer and the physical modification, these two aspects we are working. So let us see. we have the electrospinning machine in our lab. In this electrospinning, you can know that the electrospinning is the kind of spinning of the kind of materials in a liquid form under high voltage, and it can spun into a collector. So this is basically, you can see the we developed some scaffold with some micro fiber. These are the fiber scaffolds using the very simple chitosan fiber in some matrix, polymer matrix. This kind of fiber we are frequently prepare in our lab. So, and we saw these fibers scaffold are very much helpful in tissue development, in cell growth, and they are also biocompatible, and they produce the, they mimic the exact kind EMs, that is the environment within the body, that kind of environment they can exist in this environment, and they are very much bioactive and biocompatible. So these kind of bilayer scaffold, trilayer, even up to trilayer scaffold we can prepare with this polymer. And some results, I will not discuss in details of this result, but you can see our papers that have been published in several journals. So this is very routine job in our lab. Recently we have started electrospinning of cellulose scaffold also, and the next one is the bioprinting. So this is also for skin grafting. You can see after this electrospinning we develop some kind of pattern. Here you can see the pattern on the surface of this scaffold, different kind of patterns we are trying to develop. Why this pattern is helpful? Because it can direct the cells to grow in a particular direction, and that will ultimately accelerate the wound healing. So that is for the wound healing purpose. And this kind of 3D surface topography will help in growing the cell quickly to retain the 3D structure of this scaffold. Excuse me. So not only the electrospinning, we also have the 3D bioprinter. Actually, 3D bioprinter is the, you can say, the cousin of 3D printer, that is only working with some live cell. The polymer along with some live cell and some chemical ingredient as a growth factor to develop the kind of artificial skin, particular drug design or tissue construct. So in our lab, we are trying to develop this kind of 3D printed biomaterials, especially for skin grafting application, for implant, mainly dental implant and bone tissue engineering application. Here you can see the main material, that polymeric material we are using, is the hydrogel. So as you all know that the hydrogels are a kind of cross-linked network, which are hydrophilic in nature and which can retain the water up to 95%, and they can made of natural synthetic polymer and physically or chemically cross-linked, and these are the environmentally responsive. So similar materials in the tissue is the activity of this hydrogel is to provide the mechanical property, water retention and lubricating property, and those are useful in drug delivery mainly. And which I am interested is the application of this hydrogel in tissue engineering and 3D printing. So here in picture you can see the lens that can be made of hydrogel that can provide you the controlled release of medicine also. So as I said, the hydrogel are being a cross-linking structure, and this cross-linking mainly we are working on the physical and mainly on the physical cross-linking based on ionic bonding. Here it is ionic bonding and the hydrophobic interaction. Sometimes we are also working on the hydrogen bonding. Here you can see this hydrophobic interaction is going on in this reaction, where you can see the hydrophobic polymer is being exposed for the hydrolysis, and finally it will create some functionality on the surface of the polymer. This functionality will make it more phobic interaction with to create the hydrogen. Similarly, in ionic gelation, the calcium alginate can be used for gelation. In our lab, this Felling bioprinter is available, and with this bioprinter, we are making kind of bone tissue engineering application, polymer ceramic based implant printing. That is the printing work, research work is going on in my lab right now. We are trying to mix the ceramic powder with some polymer, and it can be applied in kind of bone tissue engineering or cartilage printing. And I think the future work in my research group would be to generate a kind of graphene based bioink, so that this graphene based bioink can be act as a sensor or kind of array of sensors. And I do not know, maybe in long future the people may have some kind of skin which is fire resistant or non burning skin using this kind of technology. So basically right now we are hoping to work on the drug delivery system by using 3D printing and electroscaling. We are also working on some self-healing polymer gel for with a memory property. We are also trying to make some injectable hydrogel so that it will be more efficient, directly put into the patient by injection. And we are also trying to work on some artificial organ printing. That is, this is too early to comment on this artificial organ, but the work has been started. So let's see what is going to happen. Now, the question is may come to your mind that why this 3D printing is so interesting or so much catchy for the future technology. The answer is the 3D printing by use of 3D bioprinting. You can see 96% of hearing aids today are being made by 3D printing technology. So at the same time, 3D printing can help us in plenty of way. Like surgery time can be reduced up to 4 times. Here you can see twins, their brains are being attached, these twins. Just imagine this kind of surgery may take around 100 hours, continuously 100 hours for the surgeon to separate this twin. But by the help of 3D printing, we can make the CT scan of this complex thing, and we can print easily, customize the material, and we can print this same design in our 3D printer, and the surgeon can practice their surgery, or surgeon can know the in and outs of this structure, and they can be well aware of this structure before their original surgery. So it can be seen that due to this 3D printing, the surgery time has been reduced from around 100 hours to only 25 hours. So this is the advantage of 3D printing. Even in this case, that like this kind of implant here, this jaw, the lower jaw can be implanted exactly patient specific, and customizable implant can be printed through 3D printing, and it can be added directly to the patient. So the another advantage of 3D printing, just imagine that thousands of people are waiting for the organ for their transplantation, but the number or the their opportunity is not coming due to the long queue. So it would have been so nice if we can make the organ in our lab, and we can directly transplant the organ who needs it urgently. So the 3D printing can solve this problem in near future. I'm pretty much sure that we can. We already started to develop manufacturing the organ in terms of artery or in terms of prototype. The organs has already been printed in the lab, but in near future the real some real organ transplantation can be taken place due to the help of 3D printing. And also just think about the drug trial, the new drug. It takes normally on an average normally 10 years to commercialize or to see the market for a new drug. It needs several extensive animal trial, drug trial and other things, and finally only one out of 10 drugs, new drugs, will be able to see the daylight. So what 3D printing can do in this situation is if the scientists can apply their trial directly on the human tissue, that nothing like that. I mean, if we can print the human tissue in our lab and the drugs can be directly tested, or instead of any that can avoid the extensive drug trials or animal trials by the help of 3D printing. So exactly this, in this way, the scientists are working throughout the globe, and we are minimizing the time required for a new drug to come to the market. So these are the function or the application of 3D printing. So in overall, I would like to now share a video with all of you. I don't know whether it could be possible. Let me see this video. Can you see this video?
Yeah, it's visible.
Yeah, okay. So you can see that it is a kind of layer by layer printing using kind of hydrogel, polymeric hydrogel that I have spoken. These are the scaffold with this polymer, and this scaffold can be added to the live cell and it is incubated. Here also we are making scaffold with some hydrogel. Yeah, this is a kind of implant I was talking about. Yeah, in our this is live cell. The solution of live cell is being printed. Now you can mix the ceramic particles and the other chemicals with this live cell as a scaffold. It will provide the support of this live cell, and now layer by layer deposition. Here you can see, so easily it can be replaced, and you can see the growth of blood vessel through this capillary. Yeah, these are the acknowledgement where from I took the video. So these are the bio-related or biomaterials-related work that is going on in my lab. Apart from this, we are also interested in doing some kind of job or the research which is having the direct societal application, like developing a fire retardant jute polymer composite. As you can you might see that our fire retardant or fire related accident is very frequent nowadays, and in fire accident, what is the most important criteria is to give the affected people some more escaping time, so that they can escape from the spot and they can save their life. But inside the room or inside the industry, all are the ingredients that can easily catch fire, and it will give the toxic gases. That is the main reason of getting suffocating due to these toxic gases, and the main cause of death due to fire related accident. So what we are planning, that we should make some kind of interior furniture using polymers and wood or jute, and they, after catching fire, they will give you some more escaping time, so that you can go out and you can escape the spot. At the same time, the gas that will be released will not be a toxic gas. That is the main fundamental science between behind the development of this fire resistant composite. And for this, we are preparing a composite using very natural plant-based materials, so that the toxicity will be very low, and the polymer also based on the plant-based material. And we developed some composite, hard composites, and you can see this composite can be applied in interior, wall ceiling, separator, and the other applications. Here again, I would like to show you some interesting video that will give you the idea how it will save our life. Yeah, can you see this video?
Here you can see the in the left hand side, this is normal composite made of jute and it is catching fire immediately. But in the right hand side, it is treated with a polymer. And it is not catching fire even up exposed to continuous burning. It is not also exhibiting some toxic gas that you cannot see in the video, but we have checked. You see the left hand side sample is burned immediately, but in the right hand side it is still sustaining. That we developed in our lab. Okay, thank you. So this kind of interesting work can be applied in different way, like in automobile industry, the interior dashboard, interior door, interior part of the car door can be made of this kind of composites, and it will also reduce the carbon dioxide elimination, and it will balance the green and sustainable dream of future society. Again, like we also developed a interesting water filter. You can see this very low cost water filter. You can take this water filter anywhere. It is very lightweight and very mobile or handy, you can say. This water filter is made of several column. You can see column 1, 2, 3, and finally this is a column which is give you the UV light to kill the bacteria. But in this first three column, you can pour. We can actually pour in some powder, like natural plant-based powders, some other natural materials. And this is under patenting process right now. And we can see that this kind of column can remove the organic materials, toxic organic acid like fulvic acid from the surface water or river water. And if it is working in a bulk trial, then we can use this directly. We can commercialize this directly for purifying the surface water or river water to be used in some value-added application. So these are the water purifier we are also working on. And again, some microbial work we are also doing using some bacteria. This kind of bacteria is called Acetobacter zeilina, which is mainly used for the bacterial cellulose. As we said that we are interested in cellulose material because cellulose is one of the major raw materials in our research. And this cellulose, if it is can produced by bacteria, nothing like this. So this cellulose will be very much cheap, inexpensive, and we can have this in a bulk after bacteria can produce it. So this cellulose we have extracted, and this particular cellulose can be directly used as the bioplastic because it is biodegradable, biocompatible, and non-toxic. So any kind of food packaging like milk pouch and other applications, this particular cellulose material is extracted cellulose film that can be used directly in this kind of food grade packaging. So this is another interesting work going on in our center. So yeah, finally, I would like to say that I'd like to thank all my our collaborators, some national and international collaborators, along
some industries also. We are working with these collaborators for some exciting research, and you can see these collaborators are from all over the globe. Yeah, and finally, I would appeal all the prospective or aspiring young minds that if you are prepared, then come. If you are really serious with your future, if you think you can, you want to grow, you excel your talent, so you can join this MSc program. That is very exciting. That will be our fun also, and we can learn together, we can grow together for different aspect of polymer science and technology. So yeah, finally I would like to say that this is the first part of this webinar series that was based on the polymer science and technology and 3D printing and other issues. And second part, Monday, my colleague Dr. Shingo, Shubhankar Shingo, will be talking on the sensor, bioimaging, and biosensor material. So we kindly be present Monday also for some exciting discussion. And yeah, this is what can be said further. Thank you. I know that is the long time, long discussion, and thank you for your patience and for your attention. Yeah, thank you very much. And Dr. Shingo, yeah, from my my end, it is, I think I have finished my talk.
Dr. Sa, thank you very much.
Yeah,
thank you very much for your exciting and wonderful talk. And it is a brief one, but it was very exciting for the students, especially masters and PhD students, as well as for the researcher who are professional in this field, for them also. Because you talk about the opportunities for the this field,
yes,
career prospects, and as well as the everything you talk about, and then you focus on the research part, what you have done and how that kind of research can be applied for further development or hello.
Yeah hello.
Can you listen? Okay, yes. So I think it is a nice talk, and right now I can find lots of question and comments from the attendees, and
yes
I think right now we can move to there.
Yeah,
and should we move to there for, question and comment section?
Yes I'd be more than happy to answer.
Okay So I think you can also see the questions on your screen.
Okay.
But for the attendees, I would like to read it out. Okay. The first question is from Dr. Atanu Kotal. His question is, what about the non-biodegradable nature of the polymers? Presently, world facing a huge problem in this regard. Please share your view.
Yeah, Dr. Kotal, thank you very much for such an interesting question. Yes, I already mentioned in my lecture that we are also working on biodegradable polymer that is called bioplastic from bacterial cellulose, and that is our effort. But throughout the world, the scientists are trying to develop some biodegradable polymers so that it can be degraded after the use. And for this purpose, different people are using different polymers, like someone is using PBS, might be some other are using polylactic acid. For example, we are trying to use the bacterial cellulose, or some other natural polymer can be used. And finally, it has to be like this kind of approach is very important to solve this problem, like accumulation of the non-degradable plastics is very much concern of the today's world. And yeah, my research and our research group in CIU is also looking at these issues of in terms of developing bioplastic from the bacterial cellulose. So I think that is my address, my reply for this for a question from Dr. Kotal.
Okay. Dr. Sadar is a very nice I mean explanation. Now I am moving to the next one. Actually, next one is from anonymous attendee. Possibly the name of that person is Atharva Wagmore. Okay. I mean later he mentioned, because he mentioned that sir, can you send the presentation, as I think it is very much important and informative. So in this regard, I would like to ask to Dr. Saha. It is totally, it's up to you. You can address. I mean, he also sent his, I mean, gave his email ID, but it's up to you if you.
Yes, yes, I can write this email ID. Yeah. After okay. This webinar, I would send this.
Okay, then Atharva Wagmore. So thank you, Professor Saha. Will share the presentation file with you after the webinar. And next question, sir, will I get certificate for attending this webinar? This question is from Paramita Chandra. Okay, Paramita Chandra, I can address this question, particular question or comments. And we are actually very much, we'll be very much happy to provide certificate for this webinar series. And coming Monday, we will finish our this webinar series 2.0. And after that, we will circulate the certificate to all the attendees. So we are very sorry that we are making you delay, especially who attended our previous webinars. They still now they did not receive their certificate. We are very sorry for that, but we will surely provide a certificate very soon once we finish the this series, webinar series. Okay. And then there is another question from Rohit Buhit. He makes the treated means. Treated means what I followed the question when he asked this question. Actually, when Dr. Saha,
yeah.
When you showing a video of fire retardant jute, right? Fire retardant jute. At that time, you saw one side there was untreated one, another side there was a treated one. Mm-hmm. So one side the fire called it easily. I mean the jute easily catch the fire, another side that. Treated one, I mean the jute which was treated with your polymeric materials or nanomaterials,
yeah.
Right? That one was not catching fire. At that time, he made that these comments or question. So, yes. Can you briefly address this one?
I would say that this Rohit, you can directly contact me through my email, since it is a public platform and it is a like idea is all patented and it is to be patented. I cannot share it in public platform, but if you are really interested, you can directly email me, then we can discuss. Yeah, okay, I think, yeah, that much I can say. But I can say that it's entirely plant-based, some nanofiber-based treatment that we executed, and we got some results. Okay.
Hello.
Yeah, Dr. Shingo, yes.
Ah, okay, so I'm moving to the next question. From Atharva Wagmore, the question is, sir, can you tell any polymer blend for food packaging application?
Yeah, there are plenty. I mean, personally, I cannot suggest you directly like this, because it depends on the application also. Which kind, I mean, what kind of food you are talking about? Is it liquid or solid or powder form, or is it semi-solid, jelly form? That has to be taken care of. But yeah, now normally people are using a blend of polylactic acid, blend of chitosan. They are using a blend of different cellulose product also, like paper-based cellulose, the paper tetra pack, this kind of application. Even in India, for packaging, we are using jute fibers for food grade packaging. These jute fibers are very, very important, very much much neglected, but it is having a tremendous potential as a food packaging material. So yeah, depending upon your end use, you can select your polymer.
Okay, I'm moving to the next question or comments. Wagmore, I can write.
Okay, sir. I am giving him the email ID. My email.
Okay. So I am moving to the next questions or comments from Dr. Pandurangan Hari Krishnan. The comment is that it is a nice overview. As a clinician researcher and orthodontist or oral surgeon based in Chennai. He used 3D printing for surgical wafers in jaw repositioning surgeries. He is very keen to see cell impregnated 3D printing printed scaffold for medical use. Will there be any cell damage or behavioral changes due to the process of 3D bioprinting?
Yeah. So, Dr. Hari Krishnan, that is very nice question. We personally observed that, you see, during 3D printing, if the nozzle that you are using, if the nozzle diameter is varying or it is not precise, then what will happen? The pressure will fluctuate. And due to this fluctuation of the pressure, the cell might get damaged inside the syringe. That is one thing. The other thing is, like, when you are printing the bio ink, there is a kind of piston is working on this ink. You shall also be very careful on the pressure created at the piston side, because if it is not optimized, if it is not regularly checked or regularly standardized, then the piston pressure might vary. And it might so happen several times we observe, due to the lower or higher amount of piston pressure, the cell inside the bio ink might get damaged. And also during the curing, it is very critical process, the curing after printing. When you cure under UV or whenever you cure inside the liquid, some chemical liquid, it has to be very careful process. So yeah, there are always a chance to get the cell damaged, but you have to take precaution. If you have using standardized 3D printer, then I think the chance can be minimized. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Sir. And Dr. Hari Krishnan make another question. And his next question is, which polymer do you feel is an ideal electrospoon material for bone tissue engineering? PCL, PLA or PGA?
Yeah. So the three options you are giving, I would go, because I work with PCL, polycaptolactam, and we also work with PLA, but the PLA, the problem is availability. It is, once it is, it's very expensive, I think. Yeah, it is very expensive, and polycyclic acid is also in the expensive side. So personally, if you give me the choice between these three, I would select PCL. But yeah, electrospinning is a technique. At the same time, you should remember that any polymer cannot be said that it is electrospinable. It is not. It is entirely depending on the solution property, like rheology, like concentration, how much solid percentage of solid inside the your solution. So this kind of rheological properties are very important for the spinability, and also the voltage optimization, the distance between the spinneret and your collector is also these all are working together and optimized way to make it successful for the electrospinning. But you have to do a trial and error method for each and every polymer solution. Cannot be said directly that it is electrospinable. It is not. But yeah, the three you are given, all are electrospinable.
Hello, Dr.
Yes.
Sir.
Yes.
Actually, lots of attendees, they are asking for your email ID. So I wrote.
Just share, yeah.
Just I wrote the email ID on the chat box. Can you please check and confirm it is fine?
Let me see. The chat button.
Okay. So all the attendees who are asking for the email ID of Dr. Somebody, Saha, please follow.
I think raising hand. Can you unmute these two attendees?
Okay.
Maybe you don't need particularly. Dhiraj Patil. Anyway, it's up to you. If you can unmute, you can. Some questions are there, I think. No, all questions being answered.
There is few more question, but in the meeting I was trying to unmute those persons, but I don't know why it is not. Possibly you are the host at the moment, so can you try to unmute?
Okay. Yeah, yeah. Let me see. Somebody is Polash Vishwas.
Yeah. Yeah, Palash Vishwas, if you have any questions or comments or queries from Dr. Saha, you can, you are welcome. Palash Vishwas, hello.
I think not there. Again, next one is Anisha Mary Manoj. Anisha, if you have any question.
Okay, so I am moving to few more. Okay. I mean, questions there is already came in our question answer section.
Yes.
And one question is, can you tell me more about electrospinning? I think, okay, it's up to you. If you want to explain here or you can, it's up to you. Okay.
Where you got the question? Let me see the question.
Can you tell me more about electrospinning? That is the question.
Oh, that. What kind of details you are having? You can say this. Otherwise, yeah, you can directly contact me over email so that we can share something or we can continue the discussion. So, somebody is staying.
Ananda Robi Dhar. You have another, I mean, question.
Can you please comment on the health of newly generated cell like the blood capillary? Yes, definitely. I assume that you are talking about the health of the capillary, right? Not health of the patient. So yeah, the newly generated cell in the blood capillary should be continuously given the oxygen and the nutrients. That is very much important part of the 3D printing, even after printing, when you are incubating this thing. So regarding this, that's why the scientists are nowadays preparing some hollow blood vessel, extra blood vessel or channel, so that the nutrients and the oxygen can be supplied from all the way to the new cell or newly formed tissue, and to help them, it will help them healthy and working. So yes, that is fantastic question. Thank you, Ananda Ravidhar.
Okay, the next question is from Sauvik Ghosh. Sir, recently there was a deadly aeroplane crash at Kozhikode. This kind of unfortunate accident happens all over the world. Most of them are fire related. So is there any chance in future that this fire related accident can be tackled after the implementation of new polymer fire retardant in aircraft? What's your view, sir?
Oh, Sobhik, that is fantastic view from your end, but I don't know this kind of the fire retardant application that I was talking. It is mainly for interior furniture and some kind of medium to low strength application. But I am not very much sure that whether it same kind of application could be helpful for the plane or aeroplane. Because you see, aeroplane is a kind of high-end application. Once it is crashed, I don't think the fire is the factor to save the life, because it is already a high impacted accident. Okay, so even if you are using fire retardant panel in the aeroplane or aircraft, it may save when you are on the stable position, but cannot save you when you are facing kind of high impact crashing or something like that. But yeah, obviously it will give you some extra time to escape. But once the flight is being crashed, I don't think this extra time will be helpful. Because this research is basically based on the application on, you know, the indoor application or indoor furniture application. And the fire.
Dr. Saha, hello.
Yes, yes. Yeah, I can hear you.
Yeah. So, actually, there is another question from Dr. Hari Krishnan. Yeah. Do you think 3D printing is overtaking electrospinning?
If you analyze the cost-wise, if you analyze the precision, if you analyze the applications or direct application, I should say, yes, electrospinning is far more practical. I would say far more commercializable, the product, and it is in the low cost range. But if you consider the long-term effect or precision, then the 3D printing is the only option. Because you see some kind of complex design, 3D design cannot be attained by electrospinning. So my idea is to use both in a synchronized way, like some part of your material could be electrospun, some part of your material could be 3D printed. That is the best way to tackle any kind of problem. Yes.
I see. And Anand Ravi Dhar, he made another question. Whatever the question you already answered. Hello.
Yes.
Dr. Saha, can you listen to me?
Yeah.
Okay. The question previously, he made one question you addressed, and regarding that, he make in the same context of the question, and he think that he would like to ask you, if you are checking the cell death, cell health, like size and shape, on changing different constituents of scaffolds.
Yes. So, Dr. Dhar, if you are saying that the cell health in terms of size and shape, that I already said that the it depends on several parameters like piston pressure, nozzle diameter, and also the curing process. So it should be utmost care should be taken while you are working with the live cell. And also, like there is a chance for getting contamination of the live cell if it is not done in a clean room or something like that. So yes, size and shape can be varied, and once it is varied, then it can be like you can see the uncontrolled or ununiform growth of the tissue that finally would not help us in getting your job done.
Hello.
Yes.
Okay, that's fine. And Paramita Chandra again asked about the some doubt. She have some doubt about the certification. Possibly she previously attended few of our same presentation. Webinar, and she is asking whether she can get the certificate for that one. Paramita. I am sure that you can get the certification for whatever the webinar you attended, but that will be circulated possibly in the next week, because once we finish our webinar series, then we will start to circulate. So I am requesting you, please keep your patience, and you will surely get your certification. And Dr. Saha,
yes.
For the moment, I think we can move to some on different sides, especially if I talk about the your presentation, what was the it is a part of the 2-day webinar series, and the topic of the webinar series is sustainable materials, and where we are going to talk about the polymers and sensors. And for the first day, I mean day one, on this 2-day, you talked about the polymer science and technology along with the 3D printing, and not only the research field, but you also talked about the career prospects for masters and PhD students. And I would also like to first of all, I would like to thank you to you for the wonderful and great presentation and your talk and inspiring talk. And I would also inform all the attendees that there will be another webinar from this series. There will be another webinar on coming Monday of this series, that will be on materials for bioimaging and their application for chemo and biosensor. That will be given by Dr. Shubhankar Singhos, and that is actually basically it is me. And so please, we are requesting all of you to attend the seminar or the webinar also on coming Monday. And Dr. Saha, if you have anything to convey to the attendees, you can convey.
Yes, yes. I think I would request all the attendees to be present in the talk, because this talk would be very interesting and it would be very informative. And if there is any aspiring student who can continue their career for MTech followed by PhD, it would be very much beneficial for them also, because sensor and kind of biosensor and chemosensors are the, this is the technology for near future, even technology for present days also. My colleague Dr. Singho, he is specialized in this kind of sensor fabrication, material development, and in this present days where everybody is working on the diagnostic kit for COVID-19 or other infectious disease, the application of sensor, as you can see, the some apps are there, some sensing that can sense several information. This kind of application you'd listen from my colleague, and you should present from 3 p.m. Monday, 10th of August, and that would be very much helpful and very much interesting for all of us. Yes, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Saha. If you don't have much to convey to the attendees, then I think we can stop this. Finish.
Yes. Yes.
Right now. Yeah. Before we can stop this webinar right now. Okay. Thank you to all the attendees who have attended, and we are hope we can meet with you again on coming one day.
Yes. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much to all.
Okay. Shall I end this?
Sure.